Good morning. How's everybody? The hub is back. I don't know why I've done this thing. Anyway, we're glad you're here this morning. We're glad you chose to. I'm glad everybody made it through the turkey hangover to be here. I think not everybody did, but that's okay. I think we were pushing through the cold and the turkey and the fullness and all that good stuff. Just a few things I want to remind you to make sure that we're all on the same page, that we all know what's going on. If you would like to help decorate the church for Christmas, Whitney is going to be hanging out here at 6 o'clock tonight to put up the trees in here and the tree out there and the garland and the fancy, frilly, pretty, all of that good stuff. So if you would like to help with that, if you're a hand at putting lights on a tree or shaping a tree or any of those necessary skills, I'm sure she would love for you to be here at 6 tonight to help with that. Next Sunday after church, we're going to do a special outing for our kids. So next Sunday after church, we're going to take the kids and we are going to go and see, what is it called? The Star, the new Christmas movie about the real story of Christmas. It's kind of a cartoony, animated animals perspective on the birth of Jesus. So we're going to take our kids to go and see that next Sunday afternoon. They haven't released the show times for next Sunday, but if it's the same as this week, then we will leave here at 1:45. The movie will be at 2:45. And the church will provide the tickets, drinks, and popcorn for all the kids and the movie's parents. If you go, you're on your own on that one. But we'll meet here at 1:45. I'll drive my car and take as many as I can. Whitney will drive her car and take as many as she can. But any other parents that would like to go and help carpool, I think we'll go and have a good afternoon with the kiddos. Tree of Hope is on the downward spiral, so if you can bring those Tree of Hope gifts in the next couple of services, so Wednesday night or next Sunday, if you can bring in those Tree of Hope gifts wrapped and labeled with that coded number to make sure that they all go to the correct child, then we'll get them all together and move them over to the appropriate schools so that they can give them out. Anything else that I have forgotten this morning? All clear? If you guys want to stand up with me, I'm going to say a word of prayer. And I'm going to get out of the way so we can dive into some worship this morning. Father, we're thankful this morning for this opportunity we have to gather together. We're thankful that we get to come together, that we get to worship, that we have a church family that loves us and supports us. And so now, Father, we come alongside each other and we just begin to press in and praise and worship your name together. We come together this morning to declare who you are, to sing it, to shout it, to lift up our hands, to move, God, to do whatever we need to do in obedience to you, to praise and worship you for who you are in this place this morning. So God, I pray we do that without any inhibition, without any holding back. As we look into your word this morning, God, I pray you speak to us in a fresh and a new way from it. Holy Spirit, would you move through this room and individualize the message to each person in the room this morning? And as we take time to pray and respond at the end, I pray it would be a time where we really encounter and interact with you in this place this morning. We just ask you to come and have your will and have your way in everything we say and do in this place this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There is a fountain that drowns sorrow. There is no I
kids to go over for their time together. We started a series last week called In the Fire, and we're going to, I think, wrap it up today and then start looking at, I'm going to look at it in a really different way at the Christmas story for the next few weeks. But I want to keep thinking about this idea of in the fire this week, of what we do when we're in the fire, when we're in the struggle, when we're going through things. Last week we talked about Paul when he was shipwrecked, right, and the peace and the joy that he had in the midst of that. And then the ship finally wrecks and breaks up on the land, and then he gets there and this viper latches onto his hand and he just shakes it off. And we kind of examined that last week. I want to stay in Acts and I want to stay with Paul this week in another story that we're going to look at. Have you ever felt like you had something that was really powerful, but you don't know exactly how it works, so it doesn't really work for you, right? Like you've got the material, you've got the thing, you've got the directions, right? Some of you that's starting to click with you a little bit. You've got this really powerful thing, and you've got the directions, but you don't really exactly know how it works. Like Whitney's told me a couple of stories recently about these co-workers that she has, and they are of a certain age, right? She has these coworkers who are of a certain age, and they have iPhones. And let's be honest, they don't need iPhones, right? They have no need. Not everybody who's got a smartphone uses it in a smart way, right? And so they've got this phone at their fingertips, and if you look, I've read a few articles, and people argue about the number here, but somewhere between 30 and 50 devices and things that the iPhone will replace. It will replace 30 to 50 traditional devices that we used to carry around. And these people can like barely make a phone call and send a text without calling for help from Apple to figure out how to do it. Like they really have no idea the power of this thing that they have at their disposal. They know it's there, but they don't really know how powerful that it can be in their lives. It's good to have something powerful. It's even better if you actually know how to use the powerful thing. And so this morning, I want to remind you that we have something powerful at our disposal as Christians, and it's a weapon that's called praise.
Yeah.
Praise is not just the fast songs that we do at church. Praise is not just some random things that we say out. Praise is a state of mind. Praise is a way of life as a Christian where we can just speak the name of Jesus and we can just praise what we've already seen Him do and who He is, and just that praise alone has the power to break people free from chains. Just that praise alone has the power to get every demon in hell running. Praise is so powerful that it can change anybody's life, even if you know Jesus today. And so I came to propose maybe that we need to learn and we need to relearn what I'm going to call the problem of praise. Because here's the thing about praise. Praise is so powerful that it can be a problem for your problem. Now let that sink in a minute, right? Praise is so powerful that when we really start to utilize it, when we really start to use it in our lives, it becomes a problem for our problem. And maybe I don't know exactly what your problem is this morning, but I do know that praise can make an impact on that problem.
Amen.
If you've got a problem called self-esteem, I promise you, praising Jesus for who He is and who you are in Him can be a problem for that self-esteem issue. If you struggle with addiction and you start to praise God for who He is, the power that He has, and those of the power can come and it can break the chains in your life. It can be a problem for that addiction. If you have a problem looking in the mirror and seeing who you used to be rather than who you are in Jesus, if you start to praise Him, His saving grace can change what you see in that mirror. Praise can be a problem for your problem. Praise can be the antidote for your problem. Maybe this morning we need to stop and we need to ask ourselves, am I really using praise like I'm allowed to use it? Am I really using the full authority and the full power of praise in my life? Because it's more than coming to church and doing a little Pentecostal bounce, right? That's awesome, and that's in order, and that's for us to do. But if that is the extent of our praise, right? I'm going to come to church, and for 18 minutes, I'm going to praise.
And then I'm going to come back next week, and for 18 to 20 minutes, I'm going to praise. If that's the extent of our praise, we're not utilizing right. to its full Amen. Ability Amen. In our lives. It's Amen. More than just some happy Christian adjective. It's a moment as a Christian where we can face down anything, and we can say, man, I don't know what's going to happen, but Jesus, I'm going to praise you for who you are. I don't know what the future holds, but I'm going to praise the fact that I know who holds it in the name of Jesus. And so I'm going to read you what I think is probably my favorite example of praise being a problem for our problem. And it's in, we'll look here in a few minutes, but it's in Acts chapter 16. And in Acts chapter 16, when we get there, we find a couple of guys who are doing the right thing, but they find themselves in the wrong position. Has that ever happened to you as a Christian where you've been like, man, I'm doing everything right, but it seems like everything is going wrong anyway? Enter a problem called praise that we're going to look at in Acts chapter 16. Paul and Silas, maybe you've heard of it if you're an old school Christian, but we're going to go back, we're going to re-look at this story this morning. Because Paul and Silas have been traveling around, and they've been doing ministry. And to make a long story short, the ministry that they've been doing, the freedom they've been proclaiming in the name of Jesus, it hasn't really been received very well by the local officials in the community. And so a couple of influential, a couple of wealthy guys decide they've kind of had it with Paul and Silas. And so they start to get a big group in the community to kind of turn on Paul and Silas. And so they rip off their clothing. They beat the living daylights out of them. And then they throw them in jail. Now, if we're not careful, sometimes we hear these stories, right? We've grown up in the church. We've grown up hearing them in Sunday school. And sometimes we hear these stories, and we get like the rated G, happy, safe version of the story, okay? That is not how this was. Like, I can remember like the flannel graph of Paul and Silas, some of you are actually like recalling what a flannel graph was. But I can recall like the flannel graph where they stuck little people on the felt board and they moved them around to tell the story. And I can remember the visual of Paul and Silas, and they were literally sitting in chairs there like this with clothes on, just smiling like, I'm in prison. It's great. This is not how it was at all. In fact, the Bible says that the jailer threw Paul and Silas in the inner prison. Now, this is where the worst of the worst would go. There were stocks in the inner prison. And a lot of times what they would do is they would take the prisoners and just for fun, just for sport, they would figure out these really contorted ways that they could lock them in the stocks in the inner prison to really put them through misery. The inner prison was so low that you couldn't stand up. It didn't have windows, so there was no fresh air. There was no ventilation. It was pitch black all the time. And here's where it really gets real. It was 2,000 years ago. There was no sewage or sanitation system. This is the inner prison. So all the other cells on the outer side, in a lot of these prisons, would have just a little bit of an incline, right? And so when they had to go, they went in their cell. And as they went in their cell, you know what rolls downhill, right? And it all came into the inner prison. And so when Paul and Silas are sitting here in this story that we're going to read in a minute, guys, they are literally in there in this half-naked, chained up in contorted positions, right? It's completely dark. There's no ventilation. And then they are surrounded by everybody else's poop that has rolled into this cell. Like, literally, sometimes have you gotten into situations that weren't even yours, that was somebody else's poop that you got into? Paul and Silas were literally in somebody else's poop in this situation. So I want you to have all of that in context, right? I don't want to just pop up and be like, oh, Paul and Silas were in prison. I want you to really have the context of what it meant for them to be in a first century prison, right? They are not sitting, it's not like they're Otis in the Mayberry jail, right? And they're just like sitting in there singing a happy song. It is not like that at all. And so with all of that in mind, in Acts 16, I think I'm going to pick up in verse 25, it says this, about midnight. Now, why is that important? Because sometimes when the night is at its darkest, your praise needs to be its loudest. Sometimes when things look the darkest and the bleakest and the most hopeless, that is the moment when your praise just needs to be released, even when it doesn't make sense. It says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Now, if I hadn't given you the context, we would be like, man, those guys sitting there in jail just loving Jesus. And I want you to have the visual. Don't focus on it too long because they were naked. But here they are, naked, right, contorted, chained up to the wall, no ventilation, it's dark, and then the sewage from everybody else going to the bathroom is just rolling into their cell. And in that situation, they start praying and they start singing to God. Guys, we don't have an excuse most of the time to not be praising God. Because I want you to look at what Paul and Silas were going through. They didn't need a 6-month remediation period, right? They didn't need 2 years to get over and heal and deal with things, man. They were in the mess and they said, I'm going to praise God. And so they started to sing hymns to Him and they started to pray to God. Man, when you begin to praise in the darkest hour, things will begin to move and things will begin to shake in your life. When you start to catch on to the power of your praise, when you start to catch on to what it really means and how important it really is to praise in these circumstances, things will begin to move and shake in your life that you won't see coming. And then it says, and the prisoners were listening to them. I bet they were, right? I bet this is the first time that happened when somebody got put in the inner cell with all that going on, right? But they start praying and praising and singing to God. And I think that's important too. Because I think we need to realize that the world wants to hear what you're shouting when things aren't going well, right? They expect to hear us praise God when life is going great. They expect to hear us praising God when the kids are doing what they're supposed to and the bills are paid and life is good. But the world is looking at us and they're listening to what we say and how we conduct ourselves when everything goes wrong. The other prisoners were listening. And they hear Paul and Silas praising God in the midst of that crazy circumstance, right? Next verse. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bonds were unfastened. Can I tell you that that's why corporate praise and worship in the church is so important?
Right.
These dudes just started to praise and worship God in the midst of circumstances in their life that totally didn't make sense. And in the very next verse, things began to move and shake. When you praise, when you give God the praise that He deserves, even when you don't feel it, even when it doesn't make sense, even when life is at its darkest, if you will praise God in those circumstances, things will begin to move and shake in your life in ways that you didn't even see coming. Our praise together is so powerful that we can break the chains off somebody else's life that doesn't even want to be free. You ever been in church and somebody comes to church and they're there, but they're not there, right? They're there, but they don't want to be there, right? And they're there going, man, I'm going to hate this. I hate this. I hate these songs. This is dumb. I don't want to be here. And then by the end of the song, they're over there weeping in their hands because the praise has opened up the portals of heaven and the Spirit of God has just moved and He's just arrested their heart. Praise is so powerful that it can open up eyes that want to stay shut.
Yeah.
I'm just throwing that out there this morning. Verse 27. When the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried with a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, for we are all here." Now, why is that important? The doors open up, right? We know what kind of bad situation Paul and Silas were in, right? And they stayed. The prisoners, the people who didn't know Jesus, man, the doors opened up and they stayed. You know what that shows me? When you really begin to praise, when you really begin to praise through circumstances that it doesn't make sense, it will give you a love for even your enemies.
Yeah.
Even the people who treated you badly, you'll be able to show love and grace and mercy for, and you'll have a heart of compassion for them, even when it doesn't make sense, when you start to praise in the midst of those circumstances, right? Why else would Paul care about the jailer who put him in that mess except for the fact that he knew Jesus and Jesus had a hold of his heart and he was praising through that circumstance anyway? So verse 29. And the jailer called for lights and rushed in and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Now this thing is just going like ridiculous places now, right? God didn't just get him out of jail. Now revival's breaking out in the jailhouse, right? There was no altar call. There was no mention that this jailer had confessed and quoted every sin he committed. There was no keyboard. There was no sign up for the conference. There was no tithing. There was no book he had to read. There was no Christian behavior modification. This jailer saw two people worshiping God in the midst of the craziest circumstances they could be in, and apparently that was enough for him to say, man, I need that. What if the world saw us praising in circumstances that didn't make sense? What if the world saw the church acting like we had hope in Christ, the hope of glory? What if the world saw us acting like we had joy when it didn't make sense, like we had peace in miserable circumstances? What if the world saw us acting like Paul and Silas, man? Revival broke out. I mean, the jailer sees them praising in this crazy circumstances, and then they stay, right? So he doesn't lose his life. All the prisoners stay. And he says, guys, falls on his face and says, guys, what do I need to do to be saved? Verse 31, and they said, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their wounds. And he was baptized at once, he and all his family. Then he brought them up into his house and set food before them. And he rejoiced, along with his entire household, that he had believed in God. 10 verses earlier, Paul and Silas are chained up in the middle of somebody else's poo. They start to praise through the circumstances that don't make sense. God breaks them out of jail, throws conviction on the jailer. He gets saved. His whole household gets saved. They get baptized. Paul and Silas are out. They're cleaned up. They're eating good food. God moved and shook a lot in that circumstance when his people began to praise him in the midst of circumstances where it didn't make sense. Praise is so powerful. Praise is so impacting that we can get to a point where the people who caused our wounds will come full circle and they can even bring healing back into our life, like this jailer did with Paul and Silas. That's what praise can do. I want to give you a few thoughts about praise, having looked at that story this morning. And the first one is this. Praise has to overcome your preference. Praise has to overcome your preferences. And you can use the word feeling there if you want to. There's a psalm in Psalm 34. Part of Psalm 34, one says this, I will praise God at all times. I will praise God at all times. Not I will praise God for 20 minutes on Sunday morning. Not I will praise God in that rare condition when everything in life is aligned and going great. I will praise the Lord at all times. And this flies in the face of modern Christianity. I don't know how we got here, but somehow in the modern church world, we've gotten to the point that we feel like our feelings as a Christian matter. Where did we get that from? Like some people will say these words. I've had people say these words to me before when I get up with somebody and they've missed church. Well, I don't really feel like it. I didn't really feel like going to church today. I don't really feel like doing what God wants me to do. As if Jesus felt like going to the cross for you. Sometimes you've got to do what you don't feel like doing because it's what you're called and appointed to do as a child of God. But I hear it all the time. People will be like, man, I don't really feel like going to church. And I don't really feel like sitting over there because I used to have my regular seat and now we've started growing and there's somebody else all up in my seat and I don't really like the way it looks where I have to stand. And I don't really like singing those new songs because I like the old songs. And I used to sing better and I liked when we sang in that one key when so-and-so was leading it because I really like to sing in the key of A and I don't know what they're singing in now. And I used to have room to worship, man, but now I feel like I'm restricted and I can't worship and I've got people all up in my bubble and all up in my space and I can't really get my worship on. I just don't even feel like getting out of bed for church anymore. Feeling? Where in the Bible did you read that your feelings matter? I don't mean to be confrontational, but I'm going to be confrontational. Sometimes we got to do what we don't feel like doing. I promise you, Paul and Silas, we're not feeling overrun in that moment of, I'm going to praise in this moment. They did what they needed to do. They praised God. They saw the goodness of God in just unimaginable circumstances, but it was not ideal. I mean, I pray that you feel good, and I believe that Jesus can comfort you, but at the end of the day, your praise has to be your priority, not your feeling. Because there's going to come a day when you're praying over somebody who's sick and you might not feel like calling on the healer, but you've got to do it anyway. There's going to come a day when you're trying to provide financially and you might not feel like you have it in you and it might look like things have dried up, but you've got to praise God anyway in that circumstance and something can happen in your life. Praise can be a problem for the problems that try to dictate your life. You know, in church, we have a way that we will sometimes physically praise and worship, right? Sometimes we will lift our hands. And there are people who will be overly critical and overly analytical, and they will say things like, well, I don't do that hyper-charismatic worship. You ain't seen hyper-charismatic worship.
Right.
You think this is hyper-charismatic, but there are people who have said that to me. And I explained it to somebody like this one time. If you're new to church like that, if you're new to people raising their hands, right? Some people raise their hands, some people don't, right? We lift our hands. You know what that is? It is an international sign of surrender. Because guess what? You go anywhere in this world, and you go into a dark alley, and somebody points a gun at you, what you gonna do? I know what you should do. Right? You throw up your hands, right? It's an international sign of surrender. And there are times when it can feel good to come into church. And when you feel like going like this, right? You get the Sharpay face, like wrinkles are having wrinkles because your friends are. There are times when you feel like doing that you just need to do this. And you need to do this. And sometimes you need to kneel here and do that. There are times when you feel like doing this that you just need to do this. You just need to praise through the circumstances anyway. There are times in church when you just need to throw up your hands and say, you know what? Feelings, you're not going to dictate me. And even if it's awkward, and even if it's weird, and even if I don't feel it, I'm going to raise a hand if I have to and surrender myself to the Lordship of Christ, even in the midst of this muck and mire that I'm going through. I can remember growing up in church. And I can remember seeing people raise their hands while we were singing Victory in Jesus, and He touched me, and how great they are. And I remember as a kid being kind of confused by it. Like, what are they doing? They trying to ask a question? Do they need to go to the bathroom? Like, why are these people raising their hands? And they got their eyes closed, and I didn't get it. And as I got older, I think I really kind of got a grip on it, an understanding of it. But I remember going to my grandpa, and he was my pastor. And I asked him, like, why are people doing that? Why are people raising their hands? And I remember him kind of explaining to me that it was a kind of surrender and awe and praise and recognition of the holiness of God and who He is. And I remember saying to him, well, I'm never going to do that. And I remember my grandpa looking at fairly young me at that point and saying that the only reason I wasn't going to do that is because I was concerned what people would think about me. Zing! Like, that was 12-year-old me getting a zinger from Pastor Grandpa. But as I got older, and I really sold out to the Lord, and I really gave Him all of me, I realized I was going to have to get serious about this praise thing. Now, pause. This is not about the posture that you're in, right? I'm not saying everybody, every person in the room has got to raise their hand every song, because it's going to smell weird after a while if we all keep doing that. I love some of y'all. But it started to click with you after a second. It's not about putting other people in our boxes. It's not about saying everybody has to do this same thing. If you can praise God with your hands in your pockets and your arms crossed, then you go right ahead and do it. I can't. Right? I can't fully praise God
like this.
If you can, cool, but I want you to explain that to me later.
Right.
But I started to realize that if I was going to get serious about my praise and worship, I was going to have to get serious about my relationship with the Lord. I was going to have to get serious about praising Him. So I can remember, right? And then after a while, I can remember, Victory in Jesus, right? And finally, there came this breaking point where I was just like, you know what? I don't care anymore. I don't care what other people think. I don't care if I feel like lifting my hands or not. If I don't feel like praising God, I'm going to praise Him anyway. And I'm going to make sure that my body language gives off praise and reverence and awe of who God is. And I'm not just going to match it with my feelings. Because if your body language matches your feelings in church, it starts to look real sad and depressing in here, right? Because we go through stuff. We've got issues. We've got problems. We've got stuff that we go through. Sometimes we've got to be like Paul and Silas and be like, you know what? I'm going to praise Him anyway. I can remember being in an Easter service at the church that Wendy and I went to when we were in college. And they didn't really have a choir, but they had gotten a choir together. And I mean, it was not like a four-part harmony. It was like they were having church with the choir, right? They were singing and they were worshiping. But the congregation was just kind of sitting there. It was like it was just a performance. And I looked around and it's a fairly big church and everybody was just sitting there. And I just kind of started to rock. I just kind of sat there and I was looking around and I was like, I can't do this anymore. So I had to stand up. I had to worship the Lord. Yeah. I went from the kid who was like, to the only one in the room standing up, not have anything of me, but I got to a point where I realized I've got to praise him.
Yeah.
And regardless of what anybody else is doing, regardless of how I feel, regardless of what it looks like or what anybody else is going to think about me, I've got to praise him no matter what. And keep in mind the fact that we're just people. But man, we really get this mixed up sometimes. Like, if you get excited and you get pumped about something, you will lift your hands. You will go crazy. Like, let's say you're at a basketball game. Like, you're going to see Kentucky and they're going to play Louisville. Or they're going to play that North Carolina school with the fake classes to get people through school. Love you, Davey. I was at the game when Anthony Davis blocks. He's looking at me like, I got to love him right now. Sometimes it's fun to have a mic. But I was at the game several years ago when it was Anthony Davis's year at UK. And we're playing North Carolina, we're up one, right? They come down, they've got a last second shot, and Anthony Davis runs over with those 93 feet long arms and just blocks that shot. Well, I was like 8 rows from the floor. I acted a fool. Wendy acted a fool. Wendy doesn't even get that in the UK. I mean, it was like pandemonium and referendum. But I can act like that because some kid blocked a basketball shot. I don't mean to make this really overly simple parallel, but come on, guys. If I can get that excited about a kid blocking a basketball shot, now come on, we will shout it down when UK wins a ball game. And I love basketball players to death, but there is not a basketball player in this world that's going to show up in a hospital room and heal my body or help my marriage or heal my mind or break my chains. But yet we will shout down some athletes, and when it's time to praise the Lord, well, I just really don't feel like it. Do we feel like it when UK wins the ballgame? Do we feel like cheering and smiling when UK wins the ballgame no matter what's going on in our lives? Then why can't we praise God through the circumstances of our lives? You go to a NASCAR race, man. I used to be a really big NASCAR freak. I've calmed down about it a little more. My driver retired, and it's gotten weird. But you go to a NASCAR race, and there's all kinds of weird people doing weird stuff. But there's 100,000 people, man. And back in the day, when Dale Earnhardt was racing, you watched Dale Earnhardt take the lead, or you watched Dale Jr. try to take the lead before he retired in a race, man. People went crazy, right? Bah! And some of them weren't even drunk. And they're screaming, and they've got their arms raised, and they're having a great time. But then we come to church, and we make it all denominational. Like, there's different ways to praise God, so I'm just going to do it my way, right? You go to a Coldplay concert, right? There's thousands of people there. What are they doing, man? They're raising their hands. They're singing along with the songs. They're having a good time. But that makes sense. Because Coldplay's going to be there with you. Coldplay's going to lay down their life for you. When you're in a tough spot, you can call on Coldplay and be like, it was all yellow. No! Coldplay's not going to save your soul. So maybe we can just give Jesus a little more than we give Coldplay.
Yeah.
There's only one God. And he sent his son so that the whosoevers can praise him at all times. And if there's anybody who ought to have a right to get a little undignified from time to time, to give God a little bit of undignified praise, it ought to be the church. It ought to be the people who've been saved by the blood of the Lamb. Because without him, we've got nothing. And he's worthy and he's deserving of all the praise that we can lavish on him. So in case you're getting a little professional in your Christianity, remind yourself, this is not about being professional. This is not about being dignified and sophisticated and all of these things. Sometimes it's about desperation. Like, if you take notes, jot this down. We praise God not because he has forgotten who he is, but so that we don't forget who he is.
Right.
I ran into somebody one time, and he was an atheist. And so he liked to ask questions. And so he thought he had me with a zinger here. And he said, man, why do Christians worship a God that needs reminding? And I'm like, what? He says, why you worship a God who needs to be reminded who he is? How insecure is God that he needs constant reminding of his awesomeness? He thought that's what worship was, right? We had to tell God constantly, just so you know, God, you're this awesome. Just so you know, God, that's not what worship is, man. Like, the Holy Spirit is not insecure. The Holy Spirit is not moving around being like, man, I hope they bring it in the corner section today because I really need a lift. It's been a rough day healing people and filling people and freeing people and being the advocate and being on high. So I really need your praise. No. God, we worship God so we don't forget who He is. We declare who He is as a reminder to ourselves. That's why when we're singing songs, they're not just songs, they're anthems. Because we're confined to our confession. So our confession is Psalm 34:1. I will praise you at all times. That's what we're going to live. Because if our confession is, I don't really feel it, and I don't really know if God's going to show up, if that's your confession, if that's what you speak over your life, that's where you will live. But if you say, I'm going to praise God at all times, then you can praise God at all times. And you can remind yourself constantly as you praise who God is. I want to give you two reasons. Two reasons that you should praise God today. And you might be thinking, two reasons I should praise God? You've got tons. If you know the Lord this morning, you have tons and tons and tons of reasons that you should praise God. But I want to remind you this morning of just a couple of reasons that we should praise God. Because sometimes we're going to come in here, and as the church grows, and as more people kind of come in and they come alongside us, sometimes we come in and we're not feeling it. What those people don't need when they're not feeling it, they really don't need me to come alongside them and smack them on the head and say, you know what, you're not feeling it? Pull yourself up by the bootstraps and praise anyway. They don't necessarily always need that. What they need is me to come alongside them and start praising. What they need is to see me praising through my circumstances and me speaking life over them and over their circumstances and me putting my arm around them and saying, you know what? I'm going to praise with you through this valley. I'm going to pray with you through this valley. I'm going to carry you through this thing. And then over time, they'll get the picture that they should praise through those circumstances. So maybe this morning, you're already doing that. Cool. Right? If you are already praising God through the most difficult circumstances of your life, and you're like, Josh, when you go throw something new at me this morning, here's what I want you to do. I want you to just store it away. Because if you ever like just stumbled upon a candy bar you forgot you had from like a month earlier, huh. It is the best feeling. Like Grayson lost half his Halloween candy because I think the dude thought he was putting a stash on top of his dresser. Because every night I put him to bed, and the light switch is right beside the dresser, and so I put him to bed and flip the light off, and I'd be like, Hershey's. He never asked for it, right? But sometimes it's a cool thing to stumble into that candy bar that we've forgotten, right? That's what I want you to do with this. If you're already praising God, life is going good, you're like, this doesn't apply, I want you to just store this message away, because there will come a time when the darkness comes and the storm hits and you're in the fire, and I want you to be reminded of what we've talked about this morning. So number one, you can praise God right now because He's already done more than you think He has.
That's right.
He's already done more than you can even realize. He is powerful. He is faithful. He's unbelievable. He's already done more than you think He has, so you can praise Him now. Think about that. When you realize that something's already been done, a trick has already been planned, or somebody has already made a way for you, it's amazing that there's an ease that comes into that situation that you don't have to stress and freak out about getting it done. I want to remind you this morning that you can praise God already because He's already done more in your life than you've given Him credit for. He's already done more in your life than you can even realize. He's already done more on your behalf that you haven't even seen yet. Because do you think that Paul and Silas knew everything that was going to happen when they started to praise God? I don't think that they got in the prison cell, stripped down naked, beat half to death, and locked to the wall as the turds rolled in. I don't think that they got in that situation and they said, all right, boys, here's what's going to happen. We're going to sing, and stuff's going to move and shake, and the jail's going to break open, and the jailer's going to come in, and we're going to tell him everything's okay, and he's going to confess Jesus as Lord. His whole house is going to get saved, and we're going to baptize him, and we're going to get a bath, and we're going to get something to eat. I don't think that they saw that all of that was going to happen. They praised out of faith. They praised God because He was worthy. And things began to move and shake and happen that they didn't even realize were going to happen. So when they got into a prison, and they were like, oh, this is prison. This is not good. This is stinky, bad, awful, terrible, dark, gross. Even in the prison, they said, God's faithful. He's never failed anybody. He's not going to start now. So let's not panic. Let's not go to our horoscope. We don't have to check the signs and the stars because we know who created the stars. Let's start to praise. And the next thing you know, you've got two men who are a part of a revival movement that happens in the inner cell of a prison. In your life, in this week, if you find yourself just overwhelmed by the world that you're living in, be reminded of how faithful God's already been. Be reminded of how amazing God's already been. He's already done more than you've given Him credit for. So you can take a breath today, and you can realize He was faithful there. He's going to be faithful here. He's going to be faithful over here. So I can rest and I can praise God because He's already done more than I can even recognize. And there are some people who just kind of neglect God's faithfulness. Man, if that's you, if you just neglect God's faithfulness, if you just abandon everything when the storm hits, I want you to be careful and I want you to be conscious of all the miracles and all the works and all the mighty moves that you're stepping over as you backslide. Don't give up because things have gotten hard. God is with you in the midst of that situation. And sometimes I look back on what God's done, man, He's already done so much more than I give Him credit for. And I can just stay around and I can just follow Him because I've seen what He's done in my life. Here's a little tip for Monday, right? We go back to school, we go back to work, we go back to reality on Monday morning. If the devil ever tries to throw the fear of the unknown on your life, let the faithfulness of God free you from that. Because if the devil can stop you from moving forward, if he can't stop you from moving forward, he'll make you miserable while you walk. And there are so many Christians who are faithful to serve God, but they're miserable because they don't know what's next. That's actually called being a Christian, right? We don't always know what's next. We very rarely know what's next. You've got to let the faithfulness of God free you from the unknown. Like Christians do some goofy stuff sometimes. We get all caught up in goofiness sometimes. You know what? Grayson loves to do stuff. Like Grayson's 5, and sometimes he plays like he's 2 or 3, and I love it. Grayson sometimes loves, sometimes he doesn't get any warning on this. Like he's on the bed, and he decides to stand up and sprint and jump on me. Right? And if I'm not looking, that's a bad situation. But what he likes to do is he likes to run and jump and let me kind of throw him up. And I don't think sometimes I think he really thinks he's jumping as high as he is. Like, dude, you can't jump like LeBron James. You're 4 foot tall and have a 2-inch vertical. You can't jump like LeBron James. But sometimes he likes to run and jump, and I just kind of throw him up higher. You know why he does that? Because he knows that his dad is there. He knows that he's safe because I'm there. He knows that he can really run and he can go for it because I'm going to catch him in that circumstance. Can I remind you this morning that if you just stop and you just take a breath, and you would begin to realize you can run and you can go for it because God's going to catch you, because God's going to be there. God's with you in this circumstance. And God's hand of provision from the Old Testament to the New Testament speaks to the fact that He is preparing a way for your future. He's fighting battles that you can't fight. He's making a way that you can't make. And He's already done so much for you. His hand of protection is there on your back. You can breathe and you can praise God because He's already done more than you've given Him credit for. And number two, you can praise God because He's going to do more than you think He's going to do. He's supernatural. That's exciting, right? You need to hear that. Somebody needs to hear that this morning in your family, that God's going to do more than you even think He's going to do. He's powerful. And then some of you are going through things right now, and you think, man, I'm just going to try to get through, and I'm just going to survive. I really think this morning God wants you to know you don't have to just survive, but I'm going to use you, God says. I'm going to use you, and I'm going to use your story more than you can even dream. And if you're like, is this some weird, like, over-the-top, crazy, out there kind of preaching? It's really not. Ephesians 3:20 says God's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all, more than you could ever ask, imagine, or think, according to His power at work within you. To Him be the glory. God is able to do more than you can imagine. Because I gotta think, when Paul and Silas finally like walked off, I gotta think when they finally walked away from the prison and they walked away from the jailer's house, I have to think that they just looked at each other and they were like, dude, can you believe God did that? Like, they trusted God. They believed God. They had faith in God. I don't think they could imagine God was going to do everything he did in that situation when they start praising him. I have to think that they were probably like, dude, we were just hanging out, literally hanging on the wall. But we were just hanging out and we're just praising God and we're just worshiping. But then all of a sudden, like, not only do we get free and earthquake shakes the doors open, but then the jailer gets saved and his family gets saved and we're planting a church now and we're having a dinner party and people are just meeting with Jesus. I've got to think sometimes as a Christian, we've got to have this moment. We have these moments where we just shake our head at the goodness of God because he's done more than we ever thought he was going to do. So where does that leave us as a Christian? Man, you just drop the seed of praise and you let the production and the fruit be on God. Because in this equation, one of these parts is really faithful because our job as a Christian, we play the Paul and Silas role. We praise God. God's job is to do the deliverance, right? And the jailer getting saved and all the crazy stuff. We drop the seed of praise. We're faithful. We praise him in that circumstance, even when it doesn't make sense. And we let God do the rest. So some of you today, you might just feel totally overwhelmed in your situation. Get on your knees today. Do it this morning. Do it again when you go home tonight. And just start praising God for what you do know. God, I don't know what's going to happen in this circumstance. I don't know how this is all going to work out. But God, I know you're faithful. God, I know you're holy. God, I know you're good. God, I know you're the Alpha and the Omega. I'm encouraging you. I'm imploring you. Praise God in the midst of the craziest circumstances and watch the things he does that you just didn't even see coming. So I'm going to leave you with this. When you're hit with a prison season, I've been in a couple of prison seasons in my life where it felt like, man, I don't know if I can even get out of this. And I've seen God do some awesome things in those moments in my life. So I don't know what the future holds for you, but I know that there's more to come. There's more to come in your marriage. There's more to come in your workplace. There's more to come with your kids. There's more to come with your financial situation. There's more to come in this church. There's more to come in the dreams in your heart. But you've got to make the decision to say, God, I'm going to praise you. God, I'm going to bring my praise to this day no matter what. I'll bring it to the hospital bed, or I'll bring it to the party, or I'll bring it to the funeral. I'll bring my praise wherever I have to pray, and I'll bring my praise and I'll praise you no matter the circumstance, because I'm going to praise you because of what you've already done in my life, and I'm going to praise you because of what I know you're going to do in the future. We need to realize what we have at our disposal when we really start to praise God. Paul and Silas understood what they had at their disposal. They didn't understand how it was all going to work out. They didn't understand how the answers were going to come, but they realized if they just praised God, because he was worthy of their praise no matter their own circumstances, no matter their own feelings, no matter their own emotions, if they just praised God through it all, he was going to work it out. And when they began to do that, God began to move and shake and do things they couldn't even imagine. You're in the fire. You're in the storm. You're in the manhole. You're in the issues of life. If you will begin to praise him, even when it doesn't make sense, even when you don't feel like it, even when you don't want to, if you will begin to praise him in those circumstances, God will move and shake and do things in your life. I think we can say that authoritatively by the word that we've looked at this morning. So even if you're in a prison season, even if you're in the craziest, most awful circumstances you've ever been in your life, it doesn't make sense, and it certainly doesn't make sense to the world, and we can't wrap our minds around it, praise him anyway. Would you stand with me this morning? Let's pray for just a second. Jesus, I'm praying this morning that you will take this ordinary message and you will give supernatural meaning to it. Jesus, there are people here this morning that the devil has tried to rip the praise from their spirit. We speak life into them this morning in those circumstances. Jesus, for people who feel like they've lost their voice and they've lost their ability to step up and praise, God, I pray that this is the moment in the season where they realize that the devil can't take what you've given, Jesus, and that's your Spirit. God, I pray that you would encourage the disheartened, that you give rest to the anxious, that, Lord, we make a dedication, we make an affirmation, we stand resolutely this morning and we say we will praise you no matter what. God, give us that vision of praise this morning. Amen. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to let the Holy Spirit search your heart. And if there's a circumstance in your life that you realize, man, I need to praise through that circumstance, I'm going to encourage you to praise Him. I'm going to encourage you to praise Him. Maybe you do that right where you are. Maybe you come and get on your knees and you just lift your hands. Maybe you need to come and pray this morning and say, God, I just need a refreshing in my spirit. I just need a reminder of your goodness and who you are. I just need you to walk with me through this and you'll praise Him. But this morning, I just want us to be open and I just want us to be honest. If there's a storm, if there's a fire, if there's a prison season in your life that you need to praise Him through, man, don't sit here and let me talk for 45 minutes about how to praise Him through the circumstance and then just sit there. Praise Him this morning because He's worthy. Because no matter the circumstances of our life, He's worthy and deserving of our praise in those circumstances. So I'm going to invite you to come and do that. If you've never been saved this morning, I'm standing over here to my right. I'd love to explain the gospel to you, to show you the scriptures, to answer your questions. If you've never started a relationship with Jesus, I'll be right over here and I'd love to pray with you. But church, He deserves our praise no matter what we're feeling, no matter what we're going through. So would you begin to praise Him through the storms and through the fires and through the trials today? He's worthy of it.